Thank you for staying with us. Now speak to any successful entrepreneur and the common denominator is the same. They started, persisted, stayed focused amidst challenges, and boom, they made it. That's the story of Belinda Isete, the Chief Executive Officer, Bell Deluxe, whose desire to have comfortable sleeping accessories led to her current business. How to make money. Hello, Belinda, and welcome to the interview. Briefly, tell us about yourself and the journey of Bell Deluxe Luxury Sleepwear.
Hi, I'm Belinda, and I am the founder and CEO of Bell Deluxe. We are a made-in-Uganda silk sleepwear brand for urban women. The journey for me began in 2020 during the lockdown, so it's a COVID baby. And it came at such a time in my life where I was reflecting and thinking about everything that I was going through. And at the time I had no employment. My contract had come to an end, and it was such a difficult time to go through all these emotions. We're in a lockdown, we can't apply for jobs, we can't literally move or anything. And even before, when I was previously working, I didn't have time to sleep or rest and think about my life and just plan. I worked every day of the week, so I was constantly tired. And the lockdown came at such a time that made me reflect on, okay, what's my life? What do I want to do with my life? My career goals, my life goals and relationship goals and etc. And I just figured, okay, if we're going to go through this, we might as well do something about it. If we can't find the jobs, let's create the jobs ourselves. And starting a sleepwear line is directly came as something that I could relate to more, because I was having sleep problems. That's why one of the things, whenever people ask me, oh, how did you say? It's from a sleep deprivation problem to a sleepwear brand. Because that's where we began. I had sleep problems, I couldn't find a job, and all. I figured I could put the two together and start my own sleepwear line and create jobs for other people along the way.
So you decided to start out in fashion after you lost your job. But the question is, did you always have a passion for fashion? It would be a requirement for you to start out.
Fashion really came easy for me because I like to look good, I like to dress well and all. And I didn't venture into fashion for the broader part. I just said I was going to narrow down to something that was disturbing me and I could directly relate to, and that was sleep. Because I was having sleep problems, it was easy for me to sort of figure out solutions around that. And telling that story using a fashion line, a sleepwear fashion line, came easy for me. So I decided I was going to do all the research I needed to do in line with sleep. What do you wear to bed? What is more comfortable for you to wear? And what aspects are you looking out for when you're going to bed? Maybe you want something that is breathable, comfortable, really washable. And and I thought, okay, if I'm going to do that, what kind of fabric do I work with? I tested out fabrics like cotton, satin, and all these other fabrics on the market, and none of them just gave me what I was looking for, which was comfortable, breathable, washable, and really cute to wear. And when I decided to try out silk ticked all the boxes for me. And I said, okay, I was going to focus on building a silk sleepwear line, and I would make sure it's for women like myself. So that's why we have a Bell Deluxe sleepwear line for urban women.
So let's get back to material later, but how did you get your physical location here at Motive?
I joined Motive in 2021. That's after we had already launched Bell Deluxe and we're now selling products online. And I joined as a creative. I would come here for the trainings that they had in business development, in marketing, financial management, and all those were very key for me when I was starting out my business. And they provided the mentorship, they provided the knowledge I needed to be able to grow. And I stayed, I decided to stay and train with them. So early this year is when we actually launched our first physical location, which is here. And that's a great milestone for us because, look, COVID baby, and now we have our own physical location, so yeah.
Okay, so you were online, yes. And then you get your location here at Motive, and mm-hmm. that's physical. So tell us the difference between the two for your experience, and which one would you prefer?
Okay, so selling products online, I think the e-commerce market is here to stay, honestly. Much as we would, it's great to have like a physical location, most people are shopping online, and there's a lot of opportunity for you and for makers, for people like myself to like just tap into. There's so many platforms, so many avenues, so many ways to meet to meet as many clients as possible online. Because you have Instagram, where most of my clients come from. You have Facebook, you have Twitter, you have WhatsApp, and all those are avenues for you to market your business. And yeah, I think online versus having now a physical location, online is the avenue for me to let people know that we exist and we are business, get to know us and all. And then the physical location has like walk-ins and people can trust that we actually exist and all. But there's not much of a difference, honestly. I appreciate the physical location, but we are really like vocal on the online thing because we are meeting so many people that are not able to come here physically. And people from different markets, people from Uganda, Kenya, Rwanda, from the US as well. And you can't lock that down to a physical location, so.
Well, from all material on the market, you said that silk ticks all your boxes, considering weather, you know, weight, and the easiness in washing. So how come you're able to sell silk in such a hot country? Uganda is very hot. And I really want to understand how you're able to sell this silk to the urban women of Uganda in this hot weather.
One thing I had to like make sure we work on was the designs. We are really hot country, and when you tell people silk, they're like, okay, isn't it hot? Doesn't it heat up at night? But then we said, okay, our designs are going to be flexible designs. Someone can easily wear them, but still feel aerated, like they're loose fit. The designs are a bit open, so they allow for aeration and they're very thermoregulating. And I had to like do a lot of research around that on the design, and also talk about the aspect that silk has the ability to dry very fast on the body. Like when it's wet, it dries very fast, and it allows for moisture to like transfer from the body into the atmosphere, which so many other fabrics don't do. When you're sweating, it just retains the whole sweat inside, the whole moisture inside the body, so which is really uncomfortable. And when we are talking to our customers, we tell them our designs are very comfortable. They enable you to like have all those experiences, feel breathable, feel comfortable, they are loose fit. And yeah, that's how we tackle that aspect.
Now, to be able to have silk, I'm sure you import, because we don't have a silk plant here in Uganda. So where do you get your supply, and how are you able to have constant silk to be able to make your materials?
So we have a couple of suppliers that we work with. They purchase from China, from Dubai and Thailand, and we purchase our fabric from them, and then we do the production here. We do the cutting, we make the designs first of all, then we cut, and then we stitch, and do quality control, of course, and then packaging, and then deliver to our customers.
So you say that the Belle Deluxe is a product made from Uganda, and that reminds me of Bubu. What's your experience with Ugandans believing that products made from Uganda are never that good, and we need to go to the US, to China, to other places to be able to get quality material?
So it's a made in Uganda brand, so everything is made here. And yeah, I work with a team. I started out by saying I wanted to create jobs for so many other people, young people like myself. And that was very essential from the beginning. I said, okay, I'll make the designs, we'll run the marketing and all. I'll have a team of people doing the stitching, our seamstresses. Then we have a team of people that help us with they do the graphics and the packaging. And then we have a team of people that do the logistics, transferring these products, delivering these products to our clients. That's one of the things I set out to do. We're going to create jobs along our value chain, and that's what we are doing now. So we have to be very, very flexible as business owners, honestly. When a client tells you, you delivered this product and it wasn't done so nicely, you should be willing to redo it at your own cost, but also take in the fact that you're learning from this and sort of write down the steps of how you're making the products, how to avoid making the same mistake again. But also in the mind of the client, the more you're flexible, the more you're willing to make adjustments when something is not right, you're winning their trust over and they'll be able to bring more clients back to you. And I think we need to also just encourage Ugandans to support Ugandan businesses, because it's very important. You're not just, when you're buying from China, you're blocking out all these other people that could have benefited from you purchasing Ugandan products. When you buy our products, you're providing a job for every one of those people along our value chain. And we need to push that. We need to, okay, yes, you're supporting the local economy, which is great, but also you're encouraging these young makers, you're encouraging us to like keep improving the quality of our products and pursue bigger dreams, like, okay, how do we get to that place where we are now also exporting to China and Europe? Because it's very important. It's very important for our economy to grow, and that's how it can grow, through foreign exchange, through us doing more business with bigger countries, but also through local consumption by the local market, the Ugandan market.
That's awesome. I guess eventually we shall be able to make Ugandans believe that actually Uganda has good products, and we shall be able to sell and buy Uganda, build Uganda. So let's talk about taxation. What's your experience as a startup in Uganda with the taxation policies of this country? What has it been like for you?
Okay, so it's brutal, to be honest. It's quite brutal. Yeah, the taxes just make the cost of production very high, which also makes our Ugandan products very expensive for the local market. Imported products, surprisingly, are more cheaper, which really hinders the ability of local companies and SMEs to grow and sort of compete at the same level with these other big, these other already established international firms. So yeah, taxes don't make it easy for us, especially on raw materials. They're very high, and taxes on social media, internet is very expensive. In East Africa, I think we are the most expensive internet using organized country, sort of, yeah. So, and businesses are going online. If we want to compete with the rest of the world, we need to make the things that make this possible cheaper, like the internet, it should be cheaper. Raw materials, if we want to grow, like if we're pushing for bubu, honestly, we start with the raw materials that are not here. We don't have a silk plant here. So it's definitely being the silk that we need and people are using on a daily basis is imported. And if we want to push that out of the system, we start with the raw materials, the taxes on raw materials, the taxes on internet, and so many other products that we are importing. Because we want to push for import substitution, and that is very important.
So tonight, government officials are watching the show. What is that one thing you would love to request from government as a startup to be able to maneuver the environment of this business in Uganda?
Please make access to funding easier. It's very difficult for us young people to access funds, honestly. And they keep saying they are pushing money to all these places, but we don't see the money. And honestly, we are really working hard and hoping somehow someone out there can sort of reach out and give us the support we need. We need finances to enable our businesses scale. And I think the government can come up with structures to sort of gauge, okay, which kind of business can we support? Which kind of setup can we support and give the funding? And work with organizations like Motive, because they already have the young people that are doing all these awesome things. And they need support. There's need for money for us to be able to grow our businesses and to be able to employ several other young people along the value chain. So, yeah.
All right, so it took you reflection as a young person after losing your job in COVID-19 to be able to, you know, dig deep in your mind and start this business. How would you advise young people out there who are watching tonight on the way to bring their dream to life?
To be honest, nobody is coming for you. It's that brutal and that honest. You need to sit back and really reflect on what you want with your life. God has given you everything you would need to be able to succeed. He has given you life, and I think once you reach, if you feel like life is not going the way you'd want it to, to go, then I think it's time for you to just push back, write down the things you dream about and things you would want to achieve in your life, and start looking. The more you look, the more you'll find. Look for the networks, look for people who are doing what you wish to do in the future or what you want to engage in. Look for such networks, hang out with such people, have conversations around that. Go to YouTube and learn, and join networks like Motive, where young people are coming and innovating and doing so many amazing things. And surround yourself with the knowledge you need. You can do it. The most important thing is you have life. Once you have life, you can do anything. You can achieve anything you want in life.
Okay, and finally, Belinda, what's your dream in about 5 years from now, and where you'd love to see your brand, Belle Deluxe Luxury Sleepwear?
Okay, so of course, my dream, honestly, is to just have our products in as many stores in and outside Uganda. That's my dream, honestly. And I won't mention the stores that I want them to be. We're seeing our Made in Uganda brand now sell to Kenya, Rwanda, to Germany and the UK and the US. That's my dream in the next 5 years.
Congratulations, Belinda, and I wish you the best in this journey, and I can't wait to buy these brands from several stores around the world. Thank you very much for making time for this interview. Having sat down with Belinda, the CEO of Belle Deluxe, one thing I learned is the fact that she was able to sit back and think through her life and started a business planning never to look back. You too can do it. Now, on Personal Finance Tonight, Augustine Tamale, the Chief Financial Officer Vision Group, shares marketing strategies that will help you break through.
Augustine Tamale are my names. And the last time we talked, we introduced the concept of agribusiness. This is farming with a view of income generation. We mentioned that you do your research on two fronts. You interact with people who are practically farming so that you understand the hands-on issues that are happening in the field. Then you talk to the scientists, the veterinary experts, and those agriculture scientists to advise you as well. You will compare the two sides and be able to come out with the best option for you that will help you to succeed. But one of the things that is disturbing us now is the market. The market is tricky. You can grow sweet potatoes and you are shocked by the change in price. The moment the sweet potatoes are many on the market, the price drops by even 50%. And then you will not be able to even recover the expenses you incurred. So you need to grow certain items with a market in view. So you start by marketing. You need to partner with the schools. You need to partner with catering institutions so that you have a place you are going to deliver your produce. The same applies to tomatoes. The price swings by more than 50% and you end up in a loss. You may even fail to get that 50 because the market is flooded. The market is flooded with tomatoes and you are in a total shock. So what you have to do is to ensure you have a market. Either vendors in the market, these local markets of ours, the vendors who are going to buy from you, such that when you come to the market with your truck of produce, you are not looking for who is going to buy. You already agreed. You have already agreed with the restaurants to supply. You have already agreed with the schools to supply. That is going to help you to have market for your produce. In that way, you will avoid losses via the rotting or via a lower price. It's going to be very helpful to you. I'm speaking to you with the practical experience on sweet potatoes. I saw it. I saw it even on tomatoes. And with the tomatoes, the solution is for you to have an irrigation system. The moment you have an irrigation system, you'll produce tomatoes even during the dry season. And that time, you'll get a very high price. So throughout the year, you'll succeed because you have gotten a very good price during the dry season. And then when you turn to the wet season where everybody has grown, you have a lower price. So you'll have a balance, and then your year will be a successful one. But the critical thing I'm mentioning today has to do with the marketing. So we need to work on the marketing by you doing your personal marketing before even the produce is ready. In that way, you will have success. I had mentioned even that you need to have a mixed farming approach where you have animals, birds, and crops. So even for your animals, you need to market them in advance, such that you are not looking for people to take the chicken when they are ready. You already agreed with the people and they just begin taking. That helps you to have steady income from your farm. So agribusiness hinges a lot on the marketing. I know that cooperatives have been revived. However, they are doing more of resource mobilization. They haven't done so well on the marketing. I remember when people suffered on the maize, when the price of maize dropped significantly and people needed even credit finance from the government. So we need to come together as farmers and tackle the issue of markets. The cooperatives must handle that produce side, the produce marketing side of it. They shouldn't only mobilize the finances to get inputs into the farm and for working capital. They should help on the marketing side, because when you are united, you are able to control the price and you are able to control the quality as well. You will educate the farmers within that cooperative on the quality of the produce. So as farmers in an area, look out for each other. Ensure that you have a cooperative that helps you to market and helps you to control the quality. Once people understand that there is a high quality produce from a particular area of this country, they will give you the correct price. And then together as a nation, once the foreigners understand that Uganda has quality produce, then we will command the price as well. So it's very essential for us to address the issues of marketing, and even that will help us on the terms of payment. As an individual, you may find it hard to sell to someone on credit, but together as a cooperative, because it will be an entity, then even a sale on credit will be possible, such that you're not stuck with your produce because the customer doesn't have ready cash. You are able to sell and then collect the cash later because you are enforcing it through a group. So that is very, very key. The moment we go as individuals, it's going to be a problem for us. Even negotiating on improvements of inputs will help us together as a cooperative. So I'm urging that everybody who is thinking of agribusiness as an option of your active income source, then look at the cooperative option and we run with it together. As individuals, we may have registered some successes as standalones, but there are going to be bigger victories when we go together, because united we'll have a great command.
Thank you very much for watching The Business Show. It's time now for our Forex and Money Market reports. Thank you very much for making time to watch The Business Show tonight. We've come to the end. Make sure you feel free to reach out to us on our social media platforms. And also don't forget to attend the Harvest Money Expo by Vision Group that's taking place between the 18th to 20th of March 2022 at the Kololo Independence Grounds. Thank you once again. Have a good night and stay safe.